Hi guys, I'm Oliver. I usually post shitty animations, but today I'm doing a Dialtown video. Dialtown Friend Dating Sim is a visual novel game made by Direct Doggo, where you date people with object heads, most commonly a phone of some sort. The plot of the game is, you need someone to pay you into the funfair so you can lay your eggs. Fun. So let's talk about the Dialtown iceberg. Karen canonically has autism. Throughout her route, you can pick sarcastic dialogue options, which she doesn't like. When you ask her to take you to the funfair, she said she'd rather go anywhere else. She said it's too loud and bright. Her special interest is horses, and she enjoys painting them. Oliver has been confirmed to be trans. He made his own head, implying that he had a typewriter before getting it switched out to his current phone head. He is also gay. I needed to point that out. He is a man kisser. Bigfoot is constantly mentioned in Dialtown, but can make an actual appearance in-game, and he's dateable. He also goes to the bank every week and gets a banana from Karen. He's her favourite customer. Gingy is a cryptid, but no one is sure what animal he's mixed with. It's hard to drown, it's green, it has a tail that can regrow, it has six nipples, and it's feral. It's most likely mixed with a reptile, mammal, and a human. Jerry has 12 dogs, who all have eczema, and needs several assorted ointments to treat it. These ointments are expensive, and Jerry's job at the ticket booth doesn't pay very well. This led to his near divorce with his wife. The local hobo claims he's God on several occasions, and is even referred to as God by Gingy and the mayor. In Dialtown Chapter 3, he can actually turn into his true form, if you want to call it that. Wisconsin is a state in Northern America for those non-Americans who failed geography. Dialtown is a fictional city within that state. Doggo said on Tumblr that the city is built in a way to look like a rotary phone when looking at it from a bird's eye view. Oliver is an orphan. Lines of dialogue confirm this. Mr. Dickens saying Oliver's parents died when he was young, and Oliver saying, "Trust me, losing your parents is the best fun you'll ever have." Oliver sees Mr. Dickens as a father figure. Although it's not canon, a lot of the fandom headcanons that Mr. Dickens adopted Oliver. I'm not entirely sure how this was confirmed, but I know it's canon. I don't really have much to say about this, but he probably has religious trauma. DSAF, or Day Shift of Freddy's, is a FNAF fan game made by Direct Doggo before Dialtown. A few characters in the trilogy show up in Dialtown. You can meet Peter and Roger as passers-by when looking for a date, Harry in Randy's route, Tango in Bigfoot's route, and Abel when annoying Jerry, no set character route, and in Chapter 3. Jack is mentioned, but doesn't make a canon appearance. Roger is getting a DLC route, which we might get more references to DSAF games. Callan Crown is an important character in Dialtown, who we'll look into more later. He was born without a right arm and both his legs. During the Second World War, he built himself prosthetics. After the war, he sold soldiers prosthetics and eventually made a factory called Crown Mechanics Inc. It wasn't a sustainable business idea, however. Callan had to close his factory, or more likely, sell it, since Peter says Dialtown Mechanics Plant used to be Crown Mechanics. Mare Mingus is another important character in Dialtown. Although everyone knows her as Mingus, her name is actually Michelle. This was shown in her character sheet, saying Mingus is actually the name of Callum's old cat that Mingus took the name for herself. Gingy was searching for Bigfoot in the forest one day. It followed footprints which turned out to belong to an escaped ape at the zoo. Gingy found said ape, and the ape bit it on the shoulder. Don't ask me how. After the tragic event, Gingy was shot by a tranquilizer dart shot by Theodore Roosevelt and was taken back to the zoo. Gingy managed to escape this exhibit, though I'm unsure when it did or how long it was stuck in the zoo for. Gingy mentions this imprisonment throughout the game and shows obvious hatred for Theodore. Clowns don't exist in the Dialtown universe. Clowns were eradicated after a shooting in Washington, although there is Frungles the Clown, whose advert shows up on the pole in downtown. Though, is he a true clown? We'll never know. Randy has a bandage across his forehead that reads fuckface until Gingy changes it at the end of his route. Randy explains how it happened. The gist is, he got squished by the Madden Mediocre machine, getting a pretty bad concussion. He accidentally grabbed Lola, his girlfriend at the time's boobs, causing her to push him over onto a rock, making his innards in his head outers. Randy's surgeon turned out to be the father of Lola. He wasn't impressed with the whole accidentally groping his daughter, so he wrote fuckface on Randy's bandage. Randy tried to get the writing off the bandage, but the fumes of the chemicals made him high, causing him to be 3 days late for work. He was fired on the spot. Poor Randy. Mayor Mingus rigs every Dialtown election to ensure she stays mayor. She rigs elections by swapping ballot boxes for poorly disguised swans who have paper shredders for heads. Callum Crown, who I mentioned earlier, was the President of America from 1961 to January 1st, 1967. Before he was President, he was Senator of the State of Wisconsin, and before that, he was the Mayor of Dialtown. It was mentioned a few times in-game that Gingy can remember its past / childhood. This is pointed out by Gingy in both Oliver's Brew and in Chapter 3. It has a pretty bad memory overall due to its permanently cough-connected damaged brain. Callum Crown is Mingus's grandfather, and it's obvious she looks up to him. She has paintings of him in her office and keeps one of his old postcards he wrote back in 66. She even became the mayor, trying to live up to his legacy, trying to make him proud of her. The dial-up happened on December 31st, 1966. It was the day that everyone and every animal got an object head. The phone head and typewriter were both invented by Callum Crown before he became mayor, and when he became president, he wanted to upgrade the world to have inorganic heads. Mulla Crown was the wife of Callum Crown and was mentioned a few times in Chapter 3. She was the first lady and press secretary during Callum's presidency. She also had a history with journalism, making her fit for the role as press secretary. Since Mingus exists, Marla and Callum had at least one son together. Doggo said that Marla has a tendency to see through Callum's bullshit, and Callum didn't want to tell her about his plans for the dial-up because she might think he'd lost it. Marla is dead when Dialtown takes place, but it was alive when Mingus was born. In Chapter 3, Mingus and her goons decide to exile Gingy from Dialtown via a drugged green breakfast, then leaving it in a cat carry in the middle of the woods. On its back is a note on why it got exiled, which Jerry reads to it. Mingus says that Gingy is selfish, oblivious, and a threat to normality. Fortunately, Gingy's exile gets pardoned in Chapter 3 Good Ending. Mingus's dad, or Callum's son, is a very bad person. On Mingus's character sheet, it says she was groomed at a young age by an underwhelming tiger parent. She spent her whole life in her grandfather's shadow, eventually abandoning the urge to gain her uncaring father's approval and instead craving her grandfather's approval above all else. The way her father spoke about Callum, often comparing Mingus's achievements to his, combined with the fantasy of Callum giving her the kind of love and reassurance her father never gave her, made Callum appear as a titan in her mind. Dialtown is a Dialtown Easter egg you can activate by naming yourself omelette.exe. Dialtown is set in the Rapture, and instead of looking for a date to pay you into the fun fair, you look for someone to baptize you. That's basically it. You can also eat Nathan Hanover because he's British. The Mingling is a group of Mingus's goons plus herself that show up in Chapter 3. The group consists of Mingus, Bunny, Abel, Stabby, Shooty, Little Billy, and Theorore. In Chapter 3, Bunny is unable to show up to the Mingling meeting since he got crushed by Madame Mediocre at the end of Randy's route. And Mingus found the hobo on the street and hired him as Bunny's seat warmer. This has to be the most cursed group of characters in Dialtown. Milton R. Wallace was Callum's best friend and vice president during Callum's presidency. Milton goes completely unmentioned throughout Dialtown, although Doggo planned to mention him in one line of dialogue, it was cut because he felt it didn't fit. Milton met Callum at a rally when Callum was running for St. Senator, and the two got on instantly, talking late into the night. When Callum took office, he gifted Milton the first prosthetic hand he ever built, with the note, "For my right-hand man," since Callum is missing his right arm. It was implied that Callum and Milt were dating, but were unsure to what extent. Both Milt and Marla were mentioned in Dialtown matchmaking quiz Easter egg. Knock on wood, there is nowhere in the whole world I'd rather be than right here next to my beautiful wife Marla and my dearest friend Milt and Wolfie today. Milt was also mentioned in another Dialtown Easter egg that can show up in the chapter selection when you start a new game. It says, "I love you blank, for all eternity I love you." When using the same font with the same size, the name Milt fits perfectly in the blank. Milt was the only one Callum told his plans to the dial-up to. Milt was very against the idea, and a conversation Doggo wrote between the two during the end of their relationship, Milt says, "I told you, Cal, if you bring up that dial-up to me again, we're through. I can't lift that sword off," before getting cut off by Callum. When Callum initiated the dial-up in 1966, he and Milton had a massive argument, and he demanded his prosthetic hand he gifted Milt back. Milton ended up taking his own life before December 31st, 1966, although we don't know exactly when or how. Callum had come up with a plan to solve all the world's problems. However, due to his paranoia, he refused to write the plan down in its entirety. On January 1st, 1967, Callum stood on the tallest podium known to man and felt the hardest for it. He wore his prosthetic hand he had took back from Milt, but he still felt it was Milton's, and overshot his head's movements due to it being foreign to him. He overextended his hand and accidentally pressed a button that wiped his answering box, which stole all his memory, giving himself amnesia. When Dorco talked about this, he said, in a metaphorical sense, the guilt caused him to slip. At the time of writing this, Callum is a week away from turning 100 and has spent 56 years of his life in a nursing home, asking anyone who comes by him,
"Is the war over yet? I can't get a signal."
The reason Callum hasn't kicked a bucket yet, and probably won't anytime soon, is because he's had many body-altering surgeries. These surgeries were done by him, while awake, so his paranoia didn't trust anyone else to do it for him. His character sheet states, while Callum's robotic arm and legs are immediately noticeably visible, he also possesses internal mechanics, which somehow are enforcing all of his vital systems. Callum never accounted for a time when his mind was gone but his body was still ticking, you see. He constantly added and removed parts of his working head, staying awake the entire time. His head is a result of frenzied nights of adding and removing parts, building parts that intersect and loop around other parts as a way to keep his head's internals in perpetual motion. Mare Mingus got her head reconstructed to look just like Callum's old cat. She hoped that, somehow, looking like something he loved when he was still lucid, would bring him back to his senses. She wants Callum to remember all the great things he's done, which is why she goes great lengths and keep the town looking exactly how it did during Callum's reign. But a part of the reason why she does this is for validation from Callum. Sergeant Norm Allen is a dateable for Chapter 3, though you don't actually date him. Norm was born on the very onset of the Great Depression in a small town in Arizona. He worked hard throughout his teen years to provide for his sickly mother after his father left. Norm was a pilot of a bomber plane in the Vietnam War and sent money to his polio-ridden mother throughout the remainder of the war. Shortly after returning home, his mother passed. He was offered an army scholarship and got a PhD in theoretical astrophysics. When Callum became president, he picked Norm to be the first ever human to enter a wormhole, which he accepted. By this time, Norm had a wife and possibly kids, but he still went along with the mission. Norm went through the wormhole and NASA lost all communication with him. He didn't die, he time traveled from the summer of 66 to the 2020s. So far, we don't know what happened between his landing and his exile, but he most likely wound up in Dialtown after trying to find Callum and staying there. Since Norm time traveled from the summer of 66, he had completely skipped the dial-up, and he was the only one in the world without an object head, and Mingus didn't take kindly to that. She exiled Norm for being a threat to normality, the exact same line she used on Genji's exile. Norm took shelter in an abandoned shack only 8 miles out of town in the woods. He lived in the shack for a year or two before he met Genji, who had recently been exiled, and that's where Dialtown Chapter 3 takes place. Encounter is a Dialtown Easter egg you can get by naming yourself Encounter when starting a new game. Encounter is something that lurks on the outskirts of reality. There are theories that Encounter ties to Norm, since many eyes always watching is written on his shack. It is also theorized that Encounter has ties to Genji, since Hopo asks, "Have you ever seen a mass of red eyes whispering cryptic shit to you?" The morning after writing this, the final part of Dialtown Tool Friends was posted. The last Norm sprite had multiple eyes scribbled onto the post-it note. I think it has some relation to Encounter. For its silly game, play, and dialogue, Dialtown has a pretty sad story. If you haven't played Dialtown yet, I totally recommend buying it. It's funny, very well made, has an awesome soundtrack, and an interesting story. This is my first time making an iceberg video, so I apologize if I got anything wrong. Thank you for watching. I'll see you later.